खूप धन्यवाद सर. आपल्या पुढे आव्हानही आहेत, पण जसं डॉक्टर साहेबांनी त्यांच्या भाषणाचं समाप्ती केली आणि सकारात्मकपणे आपण पुढे जायला हवं हे एक आशावाद त्यांच्या भाषणातून आला, त्याबद्दल खूप खूप आभार सर. जॉन मॅक्सवेल हॅज करेक्टली पुट, अ लीडर इज वन हु नोज द वे, गोज द वे अँड शोज द वे. डॉक्टर तांबे सर, दिस इज अ कोट पर्सॉनिफाईड. वी आर ग्रेटफुल टू यू सर फॉर क्रिएटिंग दिस अमेझिंग प्लॅटफॉर्म and showing us the way forward. Thank you once again. We now move on to our first speaker, in fact our keynote speaker for this session and the inaugural speaker at the second virtual conference 2021 coming together for peace, harmony and progress, none other than our very own Sam Pitroda ji. Satyan aka Sam Pitroda, known as the father of the revolution in the Indian telecommunications sector, an inventor, entrepreneur, policy maker, development thinker, writer, and the list goes on. In short, naam hi kaafi hai. He doesn't need much introduction. We are extremely delighted, sir, to have you once again on this conference and having accepted our invitation as the keynote speaker. Your recent book, Redesign the World, A Global Call to Action, has been well acclaimed and a bestseller. The world was last redesigned 75 years ago, about the same time that Sam Pitroda ji was born in Titligarh, Orissa, India. Hyperconnectivity and COVID-19 pandemic offer a unique opportunity to redesign the world in a different way and take humanity to a next level. So, let's listen about this innovative concept from the man himself. Honorable Padma Shri Sam Pitroda ji, I welcome you, sir. And I set this stage open for your keynote speech.
Thank you, Dr. Tambe, Honorable Balasaheb Taro, Honorable Patrick Dagnon, Arun Bhai, Dr. Gavande, my friend Sachin, distinguished members on the dais, ladies and gentlemen, greetings from Chicago. It is indeed a special privilege and honor for me to be with you on October 2nd, one of my favorite days when we all remember and celebrate the contribution of two great leaders from India, Bapu, Mahatma Gandhi, and Lal Bahadur Shastri. To me, Bapu and Gandhi and Gandhian thoughts are more relevant today for the world than ever before, especially at a time when we were trying to recover from corona crisis and going back to new normal. It is really a special opportunity to reflect on the world we have built and the world we need to build. I was born in 1942 in British Raj. Growing up as a small child, Gandhiji and Gandhian thoughts were the key to our childhood memories. I remember in my little house in Titlagad, Orissa, we had pictures of five great leaders from India in those days that we used to look up to every day. Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Patel, Maulana Azad, and Subhash Chandra Bose. These leaders meant a lot to my generation. Being a Gujarati, my parents decided to send me to Gandhian school in Gujarat, where I really learned from my Gujarati teachers, who themselves were Gandhian, a lot about Gandhian life, which ultimately became a core of my own journey. Now at 80, when I started reviewing my own journey, I realize how important Gandhiji's contribution has been, even to my technological mindset. Because I believe Gandhiji had some very interesting views, unique views on how people should interact with people, how people should interact with community, nation, how people should interact with machines, how we should look at environment, economy, education, and empowerment. All of these things were connected in terms of fundamental values. So when I look at the state of world today, I realize that we all follow a design of the world that was conceived by US-led group of small people just about the time I was born. That design created United Nations, World Bank, IMF, NATO, WTO, GDP, GNP, per capita income. And that design was essentially based on democracy, human rights, capitalism, consumption, and military. If at that time we would have had enough visionary people to understand the value of the Gandhian thought, we would have designed the world very differently. We all follow this design, knowingly or unknowingly, as the rule-based system world over. In the last 80 years, we have not created even one new global institution. When the design was conceived, world was bipolar. You had Soviet Union and you had America. Soviet Union followed exactly opposite. Instead of democracy, they had state control. Human rights were not really valued much. Capitalism was controlled by state-based planning and economy. Consumption didn't exist, but the military was the common thread between these two designs. This design served us well. It did maintain some peace, provided prosperity, improved longevity, lifted millions out of poverty, and did some good. But at the same time, this design hasn't solved the problems of the world in terms of poverty, hunger, violence. And as I looked into it, I realized that lots of things have happened in the last 80 years. First, Mahatma Gandhi-led independence movement essentially decolonized the entire world. No one ever thought that the whole world will get decolonized in a short span of 25 years. Then rise of China. No one ever thought that China will be able to rise the way China has progressed. Then fall of Soviet Union. Rise of technology. Technology has essentially become pervasive. At the same time, technology has increased inequality. Very few people are very rich and lots of people are very poor. Then 9/11, we change American mindset and created sort of American's situation to look inward. And finally, Corona crisis. No one ever thought that one small little virus in middle of nowhere will put entire world to halt. When you look at these seven key, what I call tipping points, you realize that there are lots of new lessons to learn. First lesson from Corona crisis that we are all connected, interconnected, interwoven, interdependent, interrelated. What affects one part of the world affects the entire world. Two, at the end of the day, there are only two things that matter: planet and people. And Gandhiji talked about all these things in a very different way. Gandhiji had thought through all of these things almost 100 years ago. But he had different language. Planet is in pain today because we have created environmental blunders. Planet is in pain because our air is difficult to breathe. Water is polluted. We have cut our forests. Our marine life is in danger. All over the world, because of global warming, there is a great deal of concern as to the future of the planet. And we continue to take advantage of technology to basically destroy planet. Though we have dialogues going on for the last 25 years, but we have made very little difference in action. Two, at the same time, we haven't really treated our people with respect. Our people are in pain because of poverty, hunger, violence, inequality, discrimination. Especially at a time when the world is all connected. For the first time in the human history, we are all connected through hyperconnectivity. What does this hyperconnectivity mean to human civilization? Unfortunately, we use hyperconnectivity to improve productivity and efficiency of our systems, to reduce cost, develop new products. But we really don't use hyperconnectivity to solve the problems of our planet and our people. It is an opportunity today to take human civilization to the next level if we create a new design of the world. Gandhiji would have really enjoyed hyperconnectivity. In an unconnected world, he could take a small little incident and communicate to the rest of the world just by lifting a pinch of salt. He could galvanize millions. In an era where there was no television, hardly any radio, he was the greatest communicator ever lived. Gandhiji would have understood the potential of hyperconnectivity. He would have really thought about where to take humanity with hyperconnectivity. And inspiration from him pushed me to think about redesigning the world. I always kept asking, how would Gandhiji think about connectivity, social media, internet? What would he do with all these tools? So when I look at these seven tipping points, I realize that it is time to redesign the world with focus on people and planet. What does it really mean to redesign the world? To me, American-based design that was created 80 years ago is basically obsolete. It just doesn't work in a hyper-connected world. All of the things we see today is a knee-jerk reaction to hyper-connected world. Even the authoritarian mindset, populist movement, comes from the fact that many people are threatened because hyperconnectivity does bring democratization. Democratization of knowledge, decentralization of implementation, and demonetization of services. Hyperconnectivity is also about content. It is about curation. It is about context. These are all the things Gandhiji talked about when he discussed decentralization, bottom-up development, local initiative. All of these things relate to hyperconnectivity. Small is beautiful. Focus on small enterprise at local level to network for scale. All of the ideas of the Gandhiji probably were very difficult to implement in unconnected world. In a hyper-connected world, Gandhian ideas are easy to implement. So once again, when I look at the power of hyper-connectivity and Gandhian values and Gandhian ideas, I see a huge opportunity to completely redesign the world. Unfortunately, today, there are two designs of the world. One is the American design, and that is to continue the old design with focus on democracy, human rights, capitalism, consumption, and military. All US leaders talk about that. When Biden says America is back, what he means is that the design of the world that we had need to be taken forward as it is. Then you have now Chinese design based on Belt and Road Initiative, where China wants to get into every part of the world and offer financial packages to build infrastructure and institutions. But both of these models are based on command and control, superpower. Both of these models are based on what is good for America, what is good for China. What we need is a third model of the world design. We need a model which is not based on command and control, but based on collaboration, cooperation, co-creation, networking. That's what Gandhiji would have done. So what is this third model? How do you create a new design of the world? Democracy is not good enough because democracy today is misunderstood and hijacked by a bunch of people who think one-time voting gives them right to implement their personal agenda and not public agenda. Populist movements are all about one group of people thinking what is good for them. So when you look at the Gandhian thought, we realize that the fundamentals lie in truth and absolute truth, trust, love, democracy, freedom, justice, inclusion, diversity, local talent, local wisdom and initiative, and bottom-up development, decentralization. These are all big, big concepts. These are not just words. So today what we see in the world is truth is being replaced by lies. Trust is being replaced by mistrust. Love is being misplaced by hate. And rather than uniting people, they are dividing people. And people have hijacked democratic values. Voices of the people are not heard. Media is controlled. Institutions are captured. Scientific mindset has no value. And civil society is not at the table for discussion and dialogue with business and political leaders. All institutions are designed to benefit very few. And as a result, inequality continues to rise. In this kind of a world, we definitely need a new design. Design that takes democracy to inclusion. None of the countries are inclusive. US is not inclusive. We have here Black Lives Matter. India is not inclusive because we have Dalits, minorities. And unless and until we build inclusive society, respect diversity, peace will never prevail. If you look at all the global conflicts of the past, maybe thousands of years, all these conflicts have roots in exclusion. When you begin to include everybody, you give space to people to breathe. So we must take democracy to inclusion. But for that, you need to build democracy. You need to build institutions, scientific mindset, role for civil society, rule of law. And you need to listen to people. So if you don't build democracy, you cannot build an inclusive society. Two, human rights are not good enough. We need human needs. We need common minimum program to distribute wealth equitably to rural areas from urban areas. We need programs like NREGA. Because today we live in an era of surplus. We can produce anything. We need to decide what is that we want to produce. Today we spend $2 trillion on defense to kill people when we need only 200 billion to eliminate hunger from this planet, one-tenth of the cost. It is unfortunate that I have never heard anybody during corona crisis to say, we will reduce our defense budget to improve our health infrastructure. So we must focus on human needs and not just human rights. Capitalism has really not served well because it has increased inequality. So we need new economy. We need circular economy. We need new model of distribution. We need new theories of economy where income is distributed more equitably and there is a shift from urban to rural in terms of income distribution. It is possible. It doesn't mean you need to follow different model altogether and not allow private initiative to flourish. Privatization, globalization, liberalization is here to stay. That's a good thing to do. But then how do you manage it? So you don't create monopolies. So you don't have wealth in the hands of very few. These are all very complex questions that Gandhiji had thought about. Trusteeship was a great idea that we lost. And in the process, income got distributed unequally. Gandhiji had answers to all of these things. When you look at his song, that song, Vaishnava Janto Tene Re Kahiye, says it all. If you know how to understand, follow, all these answers are there. The question is, who follows them? How do you live Gandhian life? For that, I have always said, you don't have to follow Gandhi in every little respect. The other day, I had a two-hour discussion on Gandhiji on Clubhouse. And some young people raised a question saying, we don't believe in Gandhiji because Gandhiji would not allow us to drink alcohol, will not allow us to smoke, and will not allow us to have girlfriends. And I told this young man, I said, young man, you have misunderstood Gandhiji. Gandhiji allowed you to have the freedom you wanted. And you don't have to take Gandhi in totality. But Gandhi is all about truth, trust, love, freedom, diversity, inclusion, justice. If you don't believe in these things, then you are not following Gandhi. So today, the world needs a model where we need new economy, where a large number of people benefit from the economic development. We need also to get away from this mad consumption model. And we need to think about conservation and sustainability. And Gandhiji thought about sustainability at great length. And finally, I believe we have come to a point in this world where we can sort out our differences across the table, and we don't need to build nuclear weapons to show our strength. So we must create a condition for a non-violence and condition for non-violent world. So to me, the new design is all about inclusion, basic human needs, new economy, sustainability and conservation, and non-violence. But what does it mean to do this? It means we got to recreate our institutions. All existing institutions need to be repurposed. We need to build new global institutions. We need to restructure our governance structure, which is based on vertical silos, where hyperconnectivity requires flat organization for networking. We need to redesign our education. We need to innovate to restructure our health systems. All of these things require Gandhian thinking. I'm delighted that you gave me an opportunity today to share some of my thoughts. I spent about a year and a half locked up in corona crisis to write this book. And on every page of the book, I thought of Gandhiji. My inspiration has come from Gandhi and Einstein. Gandhiji for fundamental human values, and Einstein for imagination. I believe we can redesign the world. I believe India has a great role to play in redesigning the world, but it requires completely new mindset. I hope we celebrate October 2nd, not just by remembering Gandhiji, but following Gandhian path and Gandhian values in our own life. Each one of us will have to redesign ourselves if we want to redesign the world. First step is to redesign ourselves. Understand that we need to promote democratic values. We need to fight against authoritarian mindset. And it's a difficult task. So I hope today we all come together to make sure that the Gandhian thought and Gandhian values get priority in our own journey, in our families and friends, values and systems, and ultimately in our country. Thank you very much for the opportunity. The book is available for you to read, and I would appreciate if you seriously think today, while paying respect to Mahatma Gandhi and Lal Bahadur Shastri, by redesigning yourself. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was indeed a pleasure to hear your thoughts on this book of yours, which actually gives us an insight into the life of Mahatma Gandhi and how we can redesign the world with his principles. Aplya ekunach जडणघडणीमध्ये महात्मा गांधींच्या विचारांचा जो पगडा दिसतो तो अतिशय उल्लेखनीय आहे सर. आणि आपण नमूद केलेल्या काही मुद्द्यांवर इथे मी प्रकाश टाकू इच्छिते. रिडिझाईन द वर्ल्ड म्हणजे एकूणच समाज रचना, जगाची रचना, पुनर्रचना करणं ही जी एक वेगळी कॉन्सेप्ट इथे कल्पना आपण मांडत आहात त्यामध्ये प्रामुख्याने गांधी विचारांचा पगडा आपल्यावर आहे दिसत आहे. अहिंसा, सर्वसमावेशक कार्यक्रम, मानव अधिकार आणि शांत सरळ जीवन जगण्यासाठीची एक जिद्द ही जर आपण बाळगली तर पुढचा हा प्रवास सुकर होईल हे आपल्या बोलण्यातून स्पष्ट होत आहे. थँक्यू वन्स अगेन सर. आफ्टर दीज रिमार्क्स ऑफ युअर्स वी हॅव देवा दर्शन विथ अस. ही इज अ स्टुडंट अँड ही इज वर्किंग ऑन अ पीस अँड जस्टिस प्रोजेक्ट विथ जेरेमी कॉर्बाइन इन द UK सर. देवा वुड लाईक टू आस्क यू अ क्वेश्चन. I would request my tech team to please take Deva into the focus and you can communicate with him, sir.
Thank you.
Yes. Good evening, sir. It was a pleasure to hear your talk and it was late. I really got goosebumps whenever you mentioned regarding the world new order and stuff. Actually, currently I'm working with Jeremy Corbyn with the Peace and Justice Project over here and I'm the head of...
We lost you.
Yeah, sorry, there was some technical issues, I guess. So, like, I'm currently working with Jeremy Corbyn on COP26, actually. And these thoughts, whichever you told me, has really inspired me regarding the new world order, since I'm a student of international relations. And I always, since being a pragmatist, I always think about how come this US-based order or the new Chinese Belt and Road Initiative has been fight for a superpower and not for people or not for the common citizen. So my question here is, what do you think will the climate change activism will be like? I don't know what is happening. Yeah, okay. So what do you will be the climate change? Yeah. So what do you think will the climate change activism in the ground level in India will have an impact on a new front for a democratic front, like the people's voice will be heard or not? And what do you think India should be doing ahead of COP26? And what do you think about opposition leaders' value in this point of view, along with the ruling government over here?
First of all, I am convinced that if you want to redesign the world, you've got to do all of these five things at the same time. You cannot just focus on environment, sustainability, and global warming as the key to changing the world. Our approach to problem solving today is in vertical silos, and that's why it doesn't work. If you don't focus on inclusion, human needs, sustainability, new economy, and non-violence all together, you cannot solve environmental problem. I am convinced of that. I have not been able to convince the world because everybody is too selfish.
That's so true, sir.
Don't take little slice of the problem and try to solve it. It's not going to happen. It is time to really redesign the world. If you don't redesign the world today and go the way America wants to go or China wants to go, you will continue to have all of the problems that we have today. Inequality, environmental blunders will continue. Guarantee. But people don't get it. Because that's how we are trained in the schools and colleges and by intellectuals and think tanks, because they all have vested interest. They are not looking at planet and people. When all the G20 leaders meet, what do they talk about? Trade, geopolitical equations, economy, military. They're basically marketing. Nobody talks about planet and people together. And that's the challenge. In India, I'm very concerned about the fact that we have captured institutions, undermined democracy, affected freedom of the press. We have been vindictive on people. And today, we are spreading lies, mistrust, hate. And that's not going to get us anywhere. It may keep some people in power for a while, but when you look at the long-term history of India, you will realize that India can only flourish with Gandhian values. Love, truth, trust, justice. And these are all very important concepts. And we need to fight for it. The idea of the Congress Party and the idea of our founding fathers is rooted in Gandhian values. And whenever you try to move away from it, you will find that there'll be tension in the society. And that's what we have today. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Deva. We have another question for you, sir. And it's from India this time. We have Saudamini Kathore ji here from Sangamner. And she's an active member of the Jai Hind Mahila Manch. She would like to pose a question to you. She's speaking in Marathi. I will translate it for you.
I probably can understand.
That's great.
Namaste. No, but you may have to translate. Please go ahead.
Sampurna jagatil Sampurna jagamade vegvegya deshanmade anek prakarche lade sangharsh hinsachar va rajkiya asthirta bagta ya sampurna parshvabhumivar bharataachi ya pudil bhumika kashi asel asa aplyala kay vatte ani tyamade mahilancha sahabhag kasa rahel.
Please translate.
Yes. So basically, she's asking you that in the context of the civil global unrest that's there in several countries and across sections of society, how do you see the role of India, especially women, in this entire changing situation? Or what role should they play, you feel?
First, we have to put our house in order. If we don't put our house in order, we'll have difficulty convincing others. We need to understand that women all over the world are a major force, half of humanity. And there is no need to distinguish them. They are humanity. In fact, I wish there were more women leaders because they will not promote violence. They will promote Gandhian values by default. They are all inclusive because in the family, you have to treat everybody equally. Whenever we have women leader, we find that the world is much better and at peace. We need more women leader in the world at the table, but we don't have that. And all men think of is violence, fight, war. So I think if we put our house in order, Indian women can take a bigger role on the global stage to promote new design. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for patiently answering the questions as well and being a part of this inaugural session and giving a keynote speech on the same. We would like to see you again for our third conference, sir. And I, once again, on behalf of the Jai Hind People's Movement, I thank you once again for being a part of this first session. So, thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity and wish you all the best.
Yes, thank you.